Hello, welcome back to Discrete Calculus with the Wolfram Language. I'm Alistair Forsyth, and this episode will be about Stirling numbers. To start this lesson, I want to introduce a pretty simple puzzle I thought of. Consider a map of a park shown below. Suppose each marker marks an especially pretty sight that one might want to see during a walk through the park. And let's say that the red lines represent walking paths, and parkgoers will only walk along these paths. Now the question here is, how many distinct paths can you make such that you start and end at the same marker, but you pass each of the others? This might seem a little bit intimidating, but you can actually solve it using methods we've covered so far. Take a moment and try it if you want to. Now for the solution I came up with, we should start by noticing that there are six markers on the map, and each marker has a path leading to every other marker. For example, if we start at this marker here, we can take this path over there, this path down through here, this path to here, this path to here, and down this oblong path to here. This tells us that any reordering of the set of markers will be a valid option, as you can think of it as a cyclical permutation with a cycle of six. As a result of that, each reordering can also be written equivalently with six different starting locations, as they are cyclical. So to solve this, we take our classic definition for the permutation function, then take P of 6, 6, and then divide that by 6 so that we only count distinct paths. Evaluating this in the Wolfram language gives us 120. Now let's up the ante a little bit. Suppose two different people wanted to take a walk in the park, but they didn't want their paths to intersect. Neither of them want to miss out on any sights, so we'll have to include each marker in their combined two paths. How many distinct ways can one form multiple non-intersecting paths that cover all of the different markers such that each path starts and ends in the same place? We can actually answer this question using our Stirling numbers. So, before we do that, let's learn what the Stirling numbers are. There are actually two different kinds of Stirling numbers, and they're both used in combinatorics to do different but ultimately interconnected computations. The Stirling numbers of the first kind find the number of ways that one can form a permutation of n objects with exactly k cycles. To give us a better picture of this, we'll build up our own recurrence relation for the Stirling numbers of the first kind. When k equals 1, the number of permutations will be n factorial. However, keep in mind that each possible cycle will be counted n different times, but with different starting points. So we have to adjust that and say, when k equals 1, n 1 will equal n factorial over n, which will equal n minus 1 factorial. Now this notation here with the brackets is what we usually use for Stirling numbers of the first kind, and it's typically read out as n cycle k, or n cycle 1. Now this case, that n cycle 1 is equal to n minus 1 factorial, will end up being the base case for our recurrence relation. Moving on, we can think of taking n cycle k as a result of taking n minus 1 cycle k minus 1 and n minus 1 cycle k. This is because whenever you put a new element into an existing permutation like this, you can either put the new element into its own cycle, which we can then do one way with n minus 1 cycle k minus 1 different existing permutations, or we can put the new element into an existing cycle, which we can do n minus 1 different ways with n minus 1 cycle k different existing permutations. Putting each of these identities together gives us the recurrence relation for the Stirling numbers of the first kind as n cycle k is equal to n minus 1 times n minus 1 cycle k plus n minus 1 cycle k minus 1. Moving on, we can perform the same process with the Stirling numbers of the second kind. So Stirling numbers of the second kind find the number of ways one can partition a set of n things into exactly k subsets. Our notation for Stirling numbers of the second kind will consist of a similar kind of notation, but with curly brackets, and we will pronounce this n subset k. We should recall that because this is a proper partition of a set, each subset must be non-empty and non-overlapping. This then gives us the base case that if k equals 1 or n equals k, then n subset k will have to equal 1. The reasoning behind this is that there's only one way to put n objects into one subset, and there's only one way to put n objects into n subsets. Similarly to before, we can think of n subset k in terms of n minus 1 subset k minus 1 and n minus 1 subset k. Whenever you add a new element into an existing partition of this sort, you can either put the new element into its own subset, which we can do one way with n-1 cycle k-1 different partitions, or we can put the new element into an existing subset, which we can do k ways with n-1 subset k different existing partitions. Taking each of these identities into account, this gives us our recurrence relation for the Stirling numbers of the second kind as n subset k is equal to k times n-1 subset k plus n-1 subset k-1. Now, returning to our map problem, for two different people, we will need to create a permutation of the set of markers with exactly two cycles, meaning we should use the Stirling numbers of the first kind. Now, in the Wolfram language, we have the function Stirling S1, which returns the value of the Stirling numbers of the first kind. However, it is signed within the Wolfram language, so we have to use the absolute value function when we evaluate it. Evaluating 6 cycle 2 within the Wolfram language gives us our final value of 274. Along with that, we can use this to verify our answer to the first part of the question. Taking 6 cycle 1 within the Wolfram language gives us 120. Moving on to some notable properties, we can use the Wolfram language to get a better sense of how the Stirling numbers change with n and k. Using this piece of code, we've written out a table of n and then the Stirling numbers corresponding to n, 0, n, 1, n, 2, and so on and so forth. This effectively gives us a table where going down increases our n value and going to the right increases our k value. Something to notice here is that when n and k are equal, n cycle k is 1. This makes sense because the only way to create n cycles from n objects is to create singularly length 1 cycles, which can then only be done one way. We can use a similar piece of code to write out the same grid for n subset k, and notice that when k equals 1, or n equals k, then n subset k equals 1. Moving on, the Stirling numbers can be expressed in terms of rising and falling factorials. In particular, we can equate the rising factorial of x to the n to the sum from k equals 0 to k equals n of n cycle k times x to the power of k. For those who don't know, the rising sum of x to the power of n is equal to x times x plus 1 times x plus 2, and so on and so forth, times x plus n minus 1. Alternatively, we can write that out in pi notation as the product from k equals 0 to k equals n minus 1 of x plus k. Similarly, we can write x to the power of n is equal to the sum from k equals 0 to k equals n of n subset k times the falling factorial of x to the power of k. And for those who don't know, the falling factorial is just the opposite of the rising factorial. X to the power of n is equal to x times x minus 1 times x minus 2, and so on and so forth, times x minus n plus 1. Similarly, we can write this as the product of k equals 0 to k equals n minus 1 of x minus k. Along with that, both types of Stirling numbers have asymptotic formulas associated with them. For a fixed value of k, as n grows without bounds, n subset k will approach k to the power of n over k factorial. Similarly, for a fixed value of n, as k grows without bounds, n plus k cycle k will approach k to the power of 2n divided by 2 to the power of n times n factorial. Now, one reason the Stirling numbers are interesting to me is that they have connections from all over the place. In fact, there's another set of numbers that is sometimes called a third kind of Stirling number. Law numbers, aka the third kind of Stirling numbers, are defined as L of n, k is equal to the binomial of n minus 1, k minus 1, times n factorial over k factorial. Now, what these are representing are the number of ways to partition n elements into k linearly ordered subsets. What you may notice here is that this implies that we can write the law numbers in terms of both kinds of Stirling numbers. In fact, L of n, k is equal to the sum from j equals 0 to j equals n of n cycle j times j cycle k. In a practical sense, what this is doing is summing the number of ways to create k subsets consisting of cycles of n elements. You see, putting the elements into cycles actually guarantees a linear ordering. Along with that, the Bell numbers can be described using the second kind of Stirling numbers. In particular, b sub n is equal to the sum from k equals 0 to k equals n of n subset k. And this works because it sums the number of ways to partition n elements into any number of subsets, from k equals 0 to k equals n. We can use this to update our property from the partitions video and say that the number of possible rhyme schemes of an n-line poem with k different rhyming groups of rhyming words will be n subset k. Now, my favorite of these identities is that the Bernoulli numbers can also be described in terms of the second kind of Stirling numbers. Now, for a bit of background, one formula for the Stirling numbers of the second kind follows n subset k is equal to the sum from j equals 1 to j equals k of negative 1 to the power of k minus j times j to the power of n minus 1 divided by j minus 1 factorial times k minus j factorial. Along with that, there's an explicit formula for the Bernoulli polynomials, which follows b sub m of x is equal to the sum from n equals 0 to n equals m of negative 1 to the power of n divided by n plus 1 times the sum from k equals 0 to k equals n of negative 1 to the power of k minus n times the binomial of nk times x plus k to the power of m. Now, if we take that inner summation, we can use the binomial theorem to transform it into the sum from k equals 0 to k equals n of negative 1 to the power of k minus n times x plus k to the power of m times n factorial over k factorial times n minus k factorial. From there, we can recognize that b sub m of 0 is equal to b sub m of the negative Bernoulli numbers. This allows us to simplify our inner summation into 1 over n factorial times the sum from k equals 0 to k equals n of negative 1 to the power of k minus n times k to the power of m plus 1 over k minus 1 factorial times n minus k factorial. Now, taking that and swapping our variable names, we can see that the mth Bernoulli number is equal to the sum from k equals 0 to k equals m of negative 1 to the power of k times k factorial divided by k plus 1 times m subset k. And we've gotten to the end. Thank you for watching. In this lesson, we covered Stirling numbers of the first and second kind, some properties of the Stirling numbers of the first and second kind, and some connections to some previous topics. In the next lesson, we'll look at some techniques for sequence recognition. Again, I'm Alistair Forsyth, and thank you for watching. Bye-bye.